and our value error message. Then we define a new case in your message union case. And this will be used to react to events inside of UI and send it back to our application. We initialize the model with empty strings. We move on to the update function. And here we are going to capture the change first name message and make some really minimal state tests to handle the error process. So if the value is not equal to an empty string, we store the new value and we reset the error. But if this is an empty string, then we add the message, this field is required. And in the view, we are going to create the rendering of the input. So here I'm using full mask, so it's easier for me to have a nice display later on. But you could use any framework and have more or less the same structure. So we first have a div with the label, another div to manage the input placement, and also the help element to show the actual error. From this snippet of code, we can conclude that we need 23 lines of code per input in an application to manage them. So if you have 10 inputs in your forms, you will need 230 lines of code for managing all of them, which is a lot of code. So you got a lot of code duplication. You could also have the noisy views, and you could try to create new helpers. But if some inputs need icons and others not, you will have some duplication between the helpers. It's also error prone because, in general, if you have a lot of similar code, you will do some copy-pasting code and forget to update the reference somewhere and probably include some bugs in your application. It takes time to write and to test because it's just like that. And here we didn't even handle the server-side validation, which will add another extra layer per input. So in order to try to solve this problem and try to see if a library can solve it, we are going to create a minimal proof of concept. Let's start by doing a macro feature analysis of a form. The idea here is to understand what a form is. So here we have an example of a form, and we can conclude that we have a lot of fields. So we got a list of fields. We got some inputs. We got also a select element. So we do need to support different kinds of fields. We got some error management. We have this field is required. It's probably handled on the client side, but this email is already used, is coming from the server because the client cannot know this fact. And we also need to have some buttons like the create or cancel button so you can actually submit your forms. Let's start simple and modelize a really simple model for our library. We are first going to take the hypothesis that we are going to only use text input in our forms. So here are two examples with two different states, and we are going to create the model for them. First, we need a discrimination union to store the validation state, either the input is valid or invalid with a message. Then you got the input state, where we have a label, an optional placeholder, a value, so the current value of the input, a list of validators, so you can actually validate your input, like is it required, or does it have the minimal length, is it a valid email, and so on. And you got also the validation input state, which stores the actual input state. An input validator is simply a function that takes an input state as an entry and returns a validation state. Here is a form state records, which is a list of fields, and each field is a tuple of GUID and input state. And we also need to store a non-form message, which is the actual message the user will pass us, so we can send back the events from the form into our AdMish application. Now that we have our model, we could say that's fine, and we can just move on and give the API to your user, but there is some problems. Here, I just use a direct model directly, and so the user needs to create some new GUID each time it adds a new field. But this is an internal stuff, and the user don't need to know that we are using a GUID to identify uniquely each field. Also, an input in general is initial state is an empty string with no validators and also no errors. And so here you need to explicitly say it each time, which is not correct. And also, it's quite verbose. So can we do better? The answer is yes. We can try to expose an API to the user. And we can have two APIs possible, at least that I found. First is the computation-based expression, which is a new a feature from F#, where you can create a DSL. And so here, what we are doing is create a variable first name, say it's an input, and I set your label, your placeholder, and this input is required. And same for the surname. And we can return a form where we add each different input. The computation expression form is nice because it's easy to read. You got some nice space between your variables, so it will be easier to maintain. But we have some problem here, like it's not really easy to get iterations in the computation-based expression because you aren't scoping, forcing the IDE to have a scope compared to the pipeline style where when you say form.something, it will only show you the API from the form namespace or model, and same for form.input.something, so it's easier to discover the API. But it's a bit more compact, so I guess it depends on the feeling of different people. And when I asked this to the Fable community on the Gitter, they say, let's go to the computation-based expression for now because it seems easier to write and to read. So for the next part of the talk, we will base ourselves on the computation expression API. And now I will show you a quick demo. So here is an Elmish application. The idea is to do the side-by-side relation between the first side I show you with all the code to manage an input and see how we can manage an input now with our library. Of course, I didn't show you the render and update function, but it's something internal, so we don't expose it to the user, so we don't need to reason about it for now. First, we got a message, union discrimination, with an unformed message which is of type form message. It's coming from a library. Then we got our model where we store the form state. So each field will go inside of this property. We initialize our form, so we create the form. We create a first name input and we add it to our form, just here. We call the init method from our library, form.init, and we pass it the message and the form description. We initialize our model. We go to the update function and capture the unformed message. And just like if it was an Elmish composition or Elmish nested views or components, you call form.update and it will give you back a new state and a list of commands. And so you update your model accordingly, storing the new form state and mapping the message. And in the view to render the form, I just need to call form.render with my actual state and pass it the dispatch message function. And just like that, we now have this awesome input where I can write stuff, and it's all rendered by the library. So if I set the input to empty, it's better like that. So set the input to empty, then I got the error management working. So to the initial question, can a library solve the form problems? The answer is yes, because before we needed 23 lines of code per input, and now we need 12 lines for configuring the form and 7 lines per input. And so even for one input, we are already doing a better job than the manual way. But of course, we don't want to use the library for one input sometimes. We need to use it when it makes sense. And also to all the question about the problem with the code duplication, the noisy view, the error prone, it takes time to write. We don't have this problem because now it's all inside our library and the user don't need to take care about this duplication code or write it. Now that we conclude that a library can be a solution to a problem, we now need to test the whole features of a form, because here we just manage one input or several inputs of type text, but in a real form you got different kind of fields and also some buttons, and you need to send the form state to your server. So how can we do that with our library? First, we update our models to support several types of fields, just like we did for the text fields. So here we are going to take the select elements as an example. We create an alias key of for the type string. We create a select state, which got a label, a selected key, which is optional because by default we don't have a selected key, a list of values, some placeholder, a list of validators, just like before, and the state of the validation state of the input, or the select state, sorry. And also, in general, when you are working with the select elements, you don't have static lists. You are fetching them from your server and feeding your select element with it so the user can use them, because you want a list of users, you want a list of domain, or anything like that. And here we are going to try to do it so we can see if our fields are actually able to communicate with the server in a simple way. So in order to do that, we are adding a new property, isLoading, of type boolean, so we can actually display an animation if you are loading the data from the server. And we need to have a promise to get the list of values. So this is the values from server properties. We got the same validator function, which take a select state and return a validation state as a result. We need to create a discrimination union of called fields, so we can actually save different kind of fields in our form now. So we got some input, we got some select, and we can extend it later. And we need to modify our form state to take a list of fields now, so a list of JID of fields now, instead of just an input. We also want to add some buttons. So here we have two buttons. So from it, we can conclude that we need a button state with a label, an unclick property, which is going to have the message we want to feed back into our application from the dispatch function. And also I added the isPrimary boolean, so we can test if we can customize a little bit our input display or not, like put it in green or in white background. And in the form state, we now need to add a new property called action, which takes a list of button states. Also, when working with a form, you want to send the data to the server. So if we take this form as an example, we want to get a JSON, like first name equal Maxim, surname equal Mangel, and so on and so on. So just something like that. And from this example, we can see that we got a favlang property, which is probably related to favorite language. So we need to be able to customize our JSON fields. So we are going to just add JSON labels as a string option to our state, so the user can customize his JSON output and handle it on the server. And now I want to show you all these new features we added to the library and try to explain you how they work and how we can compare this with the actual way to manage a form with an Elmish application. So let's go back to the code. And here, I'm going to add a new input, like surname. Say this is an input with the label surname, and this is required. I don't want to add a placeholder, so I don't add this property. And I add this input to my form. I save the program, And if I go back to the view, I now have the first name input and the surname input, and I can write things in them. And it's working directly. I didn't need to set up all the data binding stuff, we could say. Then we also want to add another type of fields. So let's add a select field called language, favlang. So it's of type select. I want to add a label, favorite language. This is required. And I want to add it to my form. I can save it. And if I go back to the view, I now have a new select, but it doesn't have any values because I didn't learn it, give it any values. So we will do it. I just need to remember the function name. We say values from server and we pass it a promise. A promise which will fetch the data from the server and give it back to our select elements. So I can save the program and refresh the view, wait a few seconds. So for now we have the loading animation, and the loading animation did fade out, and now I have all the values coming from my server, and I just needed to give it a promise. So I could say closure, F-sharp, and so on. We also want to add a button so we can send the form data to our server. So let's create a submit button. We say this is a button with a label submit. And we also want to set the onclick message. So I need to create a new message inside of my message DU. Submit. So I can pass it inside of my button. And I want to style it a bit, so I will say is primary, so the button is in green background. And I add it as an action to my form, add action, submit. I can save the application, go back to the browser, and now I have my submit button working. If I click on it, I have an exception error because I didn't handle my message in my update function. So let's do that. Here, I say, when you capture submit, I want you to validate the model, or validate the form state. So let's do that. I say, new form is valid. And I will call form.validate function from our library, pass it the current model state. And just like that, I now have the new form updated from my validate option function, because if there is some errors or some error erased, my state probably change, and I also get back a boolean so I can easily test if the form is valid or not. So if the form is valid, then I will want to do so, to print something, console log, okay. If not, I will want, and sorry, I need to return the model, the updated model with form state equal new form and no comments. And here I just return the updated state and print nothing to the console. So let's save the code, go back to our browser. And if I click on the submit button, now all my fields say you have some error here and there, so I can fix them. Click on submit, and I have the OK message displayed inside of my console. And all I needed to do is describe how I want my form to react or behave, and just call the write function like validate and update at some places, and it's working. And when the form is valid, we want to get our JSON representation from our form. So we will say let JSON equal form to JSON with our current form state, and we will print it. And also, I want to customize the JSON key for five lang. So I will just say JSON label equal five lang and save it, go back to our browser, fill my form and wait for the server to give back the values. Click on submit and here I have my JSON generated from my current model state. It's taking the label as a default entry for the JSON, and if I set a JSON label, it's using my custom key. So this is why we get first name, surname, and five lang here. So if we try to make a conclusion from this second demo, is that we actually solve the problem of managing a form with inside of an Elmish application, and we don't need to reason about all of message update and things like that. We just need to describe how our form is going to behave and what fields it needs to contain. And the library will handle everything for us. We just need to handle the submit case somehow and provide the promise or things, stuff like that. Now that we know that a library is a solution because we tested the whole feature of a form, we need to plan the next features we want to add to the library before we make it public or consider it ready for an alpha. We want to support some custom files, fields, because if a user needs to use an autocomplete field or some really custom field for their job, and we don't support custom fields, then they will not be able to use our library. So this is a kind of a no-go. We also want to support server validation, so we need to describe an expected JSON format and wait for the user to respect this format and give it back to our library, like a list of key and text, something like that. Like the key is the name of the field or the JSON key, and the text is there a message, the error message. We also want to remove the strong dependencies over Fulma, because not everyone is using Fulma, and you can have a custom CSS inside of your company, or you can use Bootstrap and so on. So the idea will be to create an interface, so we ask the user to say us, this is how you render a button, this is how you render an input, and so on. And it's actually already working in another library called tod.elmish.toast, where I provided an interface and users can use this interface to customize the rendering process. So we already know it's working, so we will want to include it inside of this application or library. And also we want to add a global error support, like if a user with this first name and surname already exists, we want to print an error at the bottom of the top of our form, which we can't do for now. So what did we learn from all this talk for the form library? First, we need to start simple and really isolate our problems so we can just take small things and see if it can work or not. We need to have a way to evaluate success. So first I say, can a library solve a problem? Can I manage only text input, then several types of inputs, then add buttons, and so on? We need to test feasibility step by step. We don't need to try to create the perfect code at first, at least inside of the library. And even if in the API process, we kind of started from our model and try to say, we have the computation-based expression, API, or the pipeline, let's choose one. And for this decision, you can ask other people around you, either inside of your company, or if you are doing an open source project, you can ask the communities. So now let's see why dev-friendly tools mean more than code, because okay, as a developer, we are coding every day, we are just working all the time in our editors, but this is not the first experience we get with our products. So first, we need to keep our library focused on one task. For example, Fulma is focused on providing wrapper on top of Bulma. Todd Design is focused on providing a type-safe way to work with JSON, and is not trying to do another thing, like calling the server, or etc. And for example, in Fulma.extension, we are actually providing some wrapper for 10 or 20 Bulma extension, and this is something we want to change, because if I need to update one wrapper, I need to release a new version for all the other wrappers, and it's kind of hard for the user to know that version 1.0 of Fulma extension is supporting all these versions of the libraries. So if you have Fulma.switch radio button, and you know this is wrapping the switch button from Bulma, it's easier to do the one-to-one mappings. And so the user can know which NPM dependencies to install. You need also to take care of the maintenance costs. And for that, we have some nice tools like Fake, which is a DSL using F# to make your build step in your library. So you can say, I want to install my dependencies, I want to build the project, I want to run the test, and only if the test success, I want to publish the libraries. And if I didn't have a fake script, I need to do all the steps by hand. And if I have one project, it's kind of okay, because if I work on it every day, I can remember the steps. But when you get more and more library, it's really hard to remember which command line you need to execute in which order. And also, you want your user or potential contributors to have a really easy way to set up the library on their computer so they can contribute to our project. And if you say execute 10 commands or execute just this one command and it will take care of everything for you, it's really better. And you can also use package JSON using scripts coming from NPM. And you can also mix Fake and package JSON scripts. This is actually how I publish to GitHub pages, because I find the NPM script easier to use than the fake script. So I just use it, for example. You want to use relevant tests. And by that, I mean for Todd.json, which is a really critical project, like if I release a new version and it's breaking the decoding system, then I will break the project of everyone. So I want to make sure when I release a new version, I don't have a regression. So I have 150 tests passing before releasing a new version of it. And for Fulma, I just have some visual testing process, like the documentation itself is written using Fulma, so I know the components are working, but I don't test all the possibilities of all the components, because it would take a lot of time, and Bulma is already doing it for us as a documentation. And also, I don't want to write the expected HTML string when I create a button. I don't want to say, I want an anchor element with a class button with a space is loading, because it will be a nightmare to do. And this is not something that makes sense to do if you know the button is working with a visual state, and you kind of say, it's OK. Now we need to speak about first contact matters, and there is different ways to have a first contact with a library or a tool. First is by the documentation website. So for example, if you take Fulma as an example, you got an introduction explaining you what Fulma is, and I probably need to make it bigger. You get a gated started point where you can use a minimal template or install it manually. You got some architecture explanation, what is a React DSL, and so on and so on. You also have some special notes when you use Ionide, where I say you should disable some feature for have better performance. So it's user knows that if they have bad performance, they can disable this feature, and they don't need to discover it by themselves. Same for the type conflict, with some native some API coming from the browser. And if you go to the documentation menu, you can see all the elements supported, and you have a demo of the elements, and you can view the code, so you can have an idea of what you need to write inside of your application to make something similar. So the user see the immediate relation between the view and the code. If we take the Ionite website, this is just a single page application, like you got one page and you know more or less everything that Ionite can provide you. So you get an introduction with a GIF, so the users can see immediately if the plugin can solve that problem or not, like does I get intention, type sheeting, other things. You also have a complete list of the features. So you know you have syntax highlighting, error highlighting, and so on and so on. So you can check the list and see if it's actually responding to one of your problems. Ionite is using a website. Some other projects are using a README file. It's also OK, but a website is easier to style. You got some getting started prompt and so on and so on, so sponsor. And if you want more documentation, you can go to the documentation website if you want to know which settings can be set and so on. There is also the Babel website. Babel is something we are using inside of Fable. And when you go to their website, you see a live demo or GIF. And it's actually something you can edit to test it later, like a RPL or Ripple. You can go to the documentation, and just like Fulma did, you got what is Babel or what is Fulma. You got the usage guide, how to use it, some other documentation, so you know where to find the information. And if not, you can go to the issue or the different Slack channel and Gitter. I want to show you another example, like the worst documentation website. And I did, when I first chose a language, I was like testing a lot of language, and I find the worst language and the F# language. And when I saw the worst documentation, my first feeling was like, this is an academic language. It's probably not the case, but just because of the look of the documentation, this is what I feel as a user. And if I go to some more in detail documentation, you have like a lot of block of text and some snippet somewhere, and as a user which starts with a language, it's really hard to try to get started. And so personally, I don't like the Doris documentation for that. Perhaps there is some benefits, but this is just to say you that how you structure the documentation or the look of it can do a lot of impact of your user. So this is really something you want to polish and make it feel in alignment with your API or library philosophy. Then another way to have a first contact is by using demo. For example, we can go to the Fulma demo website where you have this application, which is a list of questions and answers. So you can see, you can ask a new question, go to the detail of an answer and have a page loader working. You can vote on an answer. You can also answer it. And you can directly test a working demo inside of your browser without needing to set up anything. So the user can directly see if it kind of works with their needs. And they can go to the source code and try to explore it. Like if they want to see the detail of the view for the show page of the question, they can go in there and try to see the relation between the media and the view they saw earlier, or they can close the project and try to remove some part of the code and see what's going to change and adapt it. So this is a way to have a first contact. Another way is to have what I call interactive preview. For tot.lmish toast, which we just call toast for easier naming, we have what I call an interactive builder, where just by looking at the builder, you can already know all the API offered to you by the library. So I can set a title. I can say I want it of type success or warning. I can set an error, an icon, sorry. And I can say, show me the toast, and I got the toast, I just described it in the form builder. And I also have a preview of the code I need to write inside of my application, and I could copy it directly. So if someone finds toast library from internet. They can go to the demo, try the interactive builder, because in general you have an idea of what your needs is. I want a title, I want an icon, I will have a message this long and this long, so you can actually just test it in the active builder without the need to write anything, and just after that, if it fits your need, you can install it in your computer. The last way of having a first contact is by having an immediate usage. And it's more and more often that we offer this possibility to the users now from the browser. So the idea is to provide your users an IDE-like experience from the browser, so they don't need to set up everything on their machine, and they can directly try your library or your language. And I only have the black theme on the RPL, so I hope it's okay. And when you see a ripple in most of the language, they say, here is how you do an hello world. Okay, that's fun. But I will never choose a library or language from an hello world sample, and we kind of make a lot of joke on it on the Gitter channel of Fable at a time, and we kind of say, what is a key point for selling Fable to other people? Answer was easy. This is Elmish for now, because this is how we structure our application, and this is our strength. And from here, we say, okay, but we can do a hello world with Elmish, but this is not fun and will not really show the power of Elmish. So what is something that users have problem to deal with and they can't immediately find the way to work with them? The answer is the inputs, because you need to have a property inside of your model, you need to have a message to capture the event from your view, you need to capture the message in your update function, and so on. So this is the default example we choose to show on the Fable ripple. Like here we got the model, we got the message, we got the initial value, the update function. We also decided to have a nice style view, so we don't just say I want to put an input and some span and no style on top of it. I want to actually explain to the user they can use class inside of the view, just like you do in your production app. So I have a div with the class main container, an input with the class input, and you can have some CSS file, so just like you do in your real world application. And on the right side, you got the live sample working directly inside your browser without installing anything, and you can try the code and work with it. So if you want to really have an hello world sample, you can put word by default in your initial model. And from this, we also have another step you can provide to the user, because if we have the Fable compiler inside of our browser, and here we are using Elmish, so we are actually saying we can support libraries inside of Fable ripple. What if you could have a link to an Elmish application which say, here is how you can use tod.json and Fable PowerPack and an Elmish application together, and have a nice, again, with some gimme, quote view. The idea here is to have an example, a simple and minimalist example, so people can know how to use your library, so tod.json, Fable PowerPack with the promise, the fetch API, and Elmish. So here we say you have a type gender with some decoder. Here is how we handle the failing case where the string is unknown. You got the user model, and you got the decoder, and this goal of this decoder is to show you are not forced to have a one-to-one mapping between your HDJSON and your F# type, so we actually write it and write an example where we show this feature, so users don't discover it by default, they just read the sample and we show them how it's working. Like for example, you can select the picture.large element of your JSON and store it at the root of your types. You got a more complex model than before with three cases. You got three messages, like I want to react to the click button, so I have the fetch random message. You want to use a promise, so you need a fetch response with a return result. You want to also handle the error case with a fetch error. Here is how you write a promise using Fable PowerPack. So we show the user how to do it, how to call the decoder and return the result. We show them how to use the update function with some comments. And we have a more complex view than before, so users can understand how we can use function to create the view, to create some of the helpers and separate things. And at the end, they got this sample on the right, and they can click on the button, generate a new user, and so on. And the part that took the most of my time working on this sample was to design a nice view that is simple and still have present all the information from our different APIs. So I got the name, I got some style with some icon, and so on and so on. So the user have a feeling of what an Elmish application can be. So when I click on the button, I have a little animation, so they can see that we can handle animation when we are fetching data, and so on. And from this point where we have some library inside of the RPL, our next step will be to provide an Elmish component of the RPL, so you can actually host a local RPL on your own doc site, so your users don't need to go to the official Fable RPL, and you can just handle the steps of the RPL and do crazy things on your own website documentation, so people can test your library directly without the need to install anything. And this is really important because in general, when you want to install something on your computer, it's going to break one time to two. When if you control the environment that your user is going to use for testing your library, like the browser, they don't need to set up anything. It will work in all the browser. So you get the chance to not have a bad feedback from a bad installation process. So the user can actually focus on discovering your API and say, yes, this library and this API is OK. And now, because I choose that this is OK, I can actually spend some time installing everything on my computer. So here, the announcement was like we are going to work on a component version of the repo, but we don't know when we will publish it. So now, some tips and advice. First, be a reader. Like read other people's code, try to watch repository or Fable repository or any repository you want to follow and you are actually using as a library or something like that. This will help you because you will discover how other people are writing their code, how they are doing their commits, because it's also a lot of things you can learn from that. And as a library maintainer, if you subscribe to a lot of repo, like the SafeTag or the Fable example, Elmish and so on, you will kind of see how people are actually using your library, and so you get some indirect feedback from your users, and you can adapt your API or your library on what you are seeing. And for example, I'm subscribing to the Fable RPL, like most of the Fable org repository, and I am watching the Fable repo and seeing Enkev and Alfonso doing commit on it. I don't understand all the code, but sometimes I just go and pick it, just so I can understand how the Fable compiler is working, and I can have a better understanding of how my application is working indirectly. So this is really interesting to do. I did the same with Ionide. When I first wanted to contribute to Ionide, I took some pull requests really small and try to see why they choose to change this part of the code and what was the application inside of the program. Also, when the motivation goes down, look back and try to see the path you did. For example, here is a V1 comparison to V2 comparison out of the JSON. So in the first version of .json, we provided the pipeline style to decode an object. This was working, okay, but the problem is like when you have 10 fields or 20 fields to your object, if all your fields are using string, you can misplace one of your line and have a nasty bug, and the compiler will not be able to help you, and you will have a hard time finding that you in a switch two lines, same for the argument order, because the argument order need to follow the order of the pipeline. So in V2, someone proposed to use decode.object function get something, and here we are actually merging the type construction with the decoding process, so we can't mess the argument order. This is really important. And it can also be a visual feedback, like here we have the V1 and Fable Ripple compared to V2, and I hope you find the V2 more user-friendly and a bit more tamed, or better tamed. And you need also to take some breaks and relax, because if you are working every hour of the day and just working, keep working and so on, you will just burn out, which is really bad. And also, you will be less and less productive, so you need to just take some breaks, relax, come back to the code later probably, and you will be more fresh to find the answer and probably find it in 5 minutes compared to 1 hour you will have need being tired. And thank you for listening to this keynote, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the FableConf, and that's it.